Never in the history of the world has education been more accessible, more flexible, and more vulnerable to disruption. That's why in the latest installment of our Future of Education study, we chose to not only identify these disruptors to the future of education, but also the unique opportunities that flow from them, so that we can all play a part in equipping students to thrive in this changing world. By hearing from 500 teachers on the front lines and delving deeper with key educational thought leaders, this research offers some clarity in this ambiguity of changes and trends. It is our hope that this research and this podcast will help this noble profession continue to be a resilient, responsive, and relational one. So joining me today in part two of this episode, exploring the disruptors to the future of education, is McCrindle's managing director and key author of the report, Sophie Renton. Hello, Sophie Renton.
Hello, Ashley Fell.
We have just been in the previous episode talking about some of these initial, you know, first disruptors, and now we're dedicating this part two episode to talking about the second sort of half of those. But before we delve into that, I thought I'd just catch our listeners up on what those trends are, all seven disruptors. So the seven disruptors impacting the future of education, and the first ones we spoke about in the last episode were artificial intelligence and technological change, individualization of learning, and mental health and well-being. And today in this episode, we're talking about the latter half, which are consumer approach to education, teacher burnout, attracting and retaining the next generation of teachers, and achieving educational reform in a risk-averse culture. So in this episode, we're going to begin by talking about the next trend, which is consumer approach to education. This is a trend that I feel like we've been observing for a while. I think personally for me, it makes sense that it relates to that kind of individualization of learning where, you know, because of our Spotify playlist and Netflix recommendations, everything's personalized, customized, it's immediate, it's relevant. There's this kind of increasing expectation for consumers of education, you know, parents, students, some of the stakeholders. Is that how you would describe this trend to people, Soph?
Yeah, I think you've captured it exceptionally well, that the consumer approach to education is really that shift from a community or a collaborative mindset to a bit more of a fee-for-service mindset around education, around how do I, not so much what can I bring to this discussion, but how do I get the greatest return on my investment? And that has, I guess, fundamentally shifted how parents and students are viewing schools and education, and the, I guess it's part of it is also connected to the recognition of the part that education plays in setting people up for life and their life after school, and the recognition of how important it is. So there is a few key, I guess, elements that build into this trend. And one of them that I think came through like quite strongly was that schools are actually increasingly being recognized for being hubs of learning and communities of learning. So which is an interesting point when we're talking about this consumer approach to education, and that there is this greater focus on this fee for service that, you know, with almost 9,500 or more than 9,500 schools, people have this element of choice. But then in an element and an era of choice, it's, well, what are your key distinctives? What are your key differentiators? And how do you engage people in on that journey? And I guess some of how this report is written is identifying what the disruptor is, but then getting the experience and the wisdom of the educational leaders and the teachers to go, well, what are maybe some solutions to that consumer approach to education? And one of the key ones that came out for this particular trend is that character and community are key focuses of great schools. And so where there's this more consumer individualized approach, there's always where there's trend, there's a counter trend to go, actually, how do we have this focus on community? How do we have this focus on character and invest into our young people, particularly when community is declining or a sense of community is in decline in so many other areas of young people's lives? And this is actually, I guess, quite an important topic when we think about the conversation that we're having around diversity across so much of our society, that there is this celebration of diversity. However, if you only are talking about diversity, you get division. And if you are only talking about the things that you unite people, it can feel like uniformity and there's no freedom of expression. And so the schools that are doing this sense of character and community really well are those that are focusing on diversity, but they're also focusing on unity and those values that actually bind them together around what do we stand for, what are we about, and what characterizes us as a community, and how do we do both of those well. And so it's this, a good expression of community is that celebration of diversity and unity, but with underpinned by care and respect. And so schools that are doing that are actually finding, I guess, that as a bit of an antidote to this consumer approach to education, that they're reestablishing this sense of community alongside building that partnership with parents, that it's when parents and schools are on the same team that they're bringing about the best learning outcomes for their children. So those are a couple of the insights into the antidotes for consumer education. Did you have any reflections on those, Ash?
Yeah, I think it's fascinating. It's easy to see, I think, why there is this increasing expectation as consumers, particularly, I guess, from a parent perspective. We know that, the proportion of students that are engaging in independent education is increasing. Some of those independent schools charge pretty high fees. And so I think there is that kind of, well, if I'm paying for this service, I want to get the return on that, and my expectation goes up. I think also just broader societal trends, even around a younger generation of parents who are tech savvy, who are there's greater awareness of what's going on in their school with their child, what other schools are doing, like that comparison almost probably drives up that consumer approach as well. But I also I think the antidote to that you explained really well there, and that came through the research around viewing it as a community and how we can input into that, and what the different stakeholders, what role they can play in that is going to be really important in the future as well. So I think you had some great insights there. The experts had some great insights as well coming into this report. But I was keen to know, Soph, would you agree with that, even around the rise of independent education and greater awareness? Do you feel like that's also driving this consumer approach?
Yeah, that is a key part of it, that when you do pay significant fees, you do expect a return on investment, and that's in schools, but also broadly across society. We often talk about expectation inflation, that for any business, any brand, the expectations of the fee and the return on that are growing, and there is that desire for personalized experience, a frictionless, a seamless experience. So I think we're seeing it play out in the education sector, but we're also seeing it play out broadly across society, which I guess is what these disruptors are. It's looking at society and going, how is society changing? And then what does that look like in the education sector?
Yeah, absolutely. The next trend is a really interesting one to be talking about. I think for me, some of these insights that we gathered from this trend were the most surprising, and some of the stats were just incredible. Maybe not in a good way, but just how high, they were. So this next trend we're talking about is teacher burnout. And I recall reading this report and seeing those stats. So if I thought I'd give you the floor with regards to what's going on in this area and the state of play, how are teachers feeling in Australia at the moment?
I would love to present some really encouraging statistics. However, that's not the current state of play. What we found was that almost 4 in 5 teachers feel burnt out after the experience of adapting to changes throughout the pandemic. And just over a third of them feel extremely or very burnt out. So it's big. It's a real challenge for educators and the education sector to, like, you don't have a school without teachers. Like, teachers are so crucial. And if teachers are feeling like this after the experience of adapting to COVID, that's really important to sit up and take note. But what's interesting, I guess, when we look at the teacher burnout is that it's not all just a result of COVID. COVID might have accelerated that, but it's not the only part. And when we asked teachers what they saw as the greatest disruptors for education in the next decade, 86% said teacher burnout is the greatest disruptor. And that's followed by attracting and retaining teachers, which highlights just a serious workforce issue for the sector. And especially when we consider population growth, increasing focus on education, that all of those, I guess, external factors combined to say if anything, we need more teachers. And if the teachers themselves are feeling burnt out, then we've got some significant challenges on the horizon. They're probably some of the remedies or ways that we explored and took wisdom from the educational leaders around how they could start to rectify that was going, I guess, on a bit of a journey within their school and looking at what is core to the teacher role and what is additional. And we referenced it very briefly in the previous podcast on this around, you know, teachers are almost not expected, but they take the role of impromptu counselor. They take the role of administrator. They take the role of sports coach. Like, there's so many hats that teachers wear, and a lot of those contexts give them different ways to engage with students and different opportunities to invest in them. And they're good because they bring diversity to the role, and a lot of teachers actually love them. However, without an intentional review of all of those different activities that teachers are doing, what happens is that sometimes the core activities don't get done, or if they do get done, teachers are burning themselves out in the process because they're doing so many things. And so there's a sense to go, okay, let's do a bit of an audit and re-clarify what's absolutely essential for teachers alone to be doing. And then what are those extra components that we can add in if there's space? Because probably another sobering stat for you was that 3/4 of teachers often feel overwhelmed by the amount of work they need to achieve in a week. And that's likely having an impact on student learning because only 17% strongly or somewhat agree that they have enough time to prepare for that effective teaching. So those are a few of the stats around, the teacher experience in the schools.
Yeah, I was not surprised to see this trend and this disruptor. But I was surprised to see that, you know, educators see it as the biggest disruptor to the education sector. Like, I probably wouldn't have hypothesized that teacher burnout would be number one. I'm not a teacher, so I don't have that perspective. I know a lot of teachers, and they do some great work, and I know that they work really hard, and then there's a lot of out of hours, you know, work that goes on for that profession and doesn't always equate, you know, to the seemingly rosy amount of holidays they get. Like, that actually doesn't even like make up for all the out of hours work they're doing during the terms. But yeah, I think it's a huge one that we have to be aware of. And I remember actually in a previous conversation on the podcast with Mike Abbasina, who's our data scientist, we were talking about AI and ChatGPT and the impact on the education sector. And he said, I think in that episode, he's like, I hope that the focus on artificial intelligence and the advancements and the changes it's going to bring and the transformative nature of it will not distract us from some of these deeper seated, longer term issues that the education sector has been trying to work on. And I think what he was talking about was around teacher well-being and burnout and attracting and retaining staff. Like, it's almost like artificial intelligence and ChatGPT, which we've acknowledged in this research is important to think about, and it's going to be a huge disruptor. It's kind of like shiny, it's new, but some of these other challenges or disruptors are things that have been happening for a while, have been exacerbated by the pandemic, probably will be exacerbated by having to learn about ChatGPT and how to, you know, mitigate that. So yeah, it's a big one, and it's a really important one. And it really, you know, well connects to the next one, which you mentioned a little bit, Soph, there, even just around the next disruptor, which is attracting and retaining the next generation of teachers. And I think it's interesting to observe that for workers in the education sector, I feel like even that comment I made just before around how many holidays you get, like, that's quite an appealing thing. I remember when I was thinking about my career choices, I always wanted to be a teacher. And I was like, not just because of the holidays, I genuinely enjoy information and learning. And I feel like sometimes even my role here is around teaching, which is cool. But yeah, the holidays are a huge perk. Whereas now in this work from home era, it's not really the case, because now there's more flexibility in other traditional, you know, structured roles, and teachers have less flexibility compared to everyone else. So I wanted to see if that was something that we investigated in the research. Do you think that came out as a challenge, even around attracting and retaining the next generation who are comparing teaching as a profession to other more flexible maybe areas of work?
Yeah, the flexibility conversation is a key element of the challenge in the attracting and retaining the next generation of teachers. Because you're right, once upon a time, teaching was viewed as quite a flexible profession with some great lifestyle benefits and perks. Yet in some ways, that's stayed where it was, and the exponential lifestyle benefits that have increased with other sectors and industries, with work from home, flexibility, work anywhere, work anytime, take your appointment, do whatever, that I guess is making education look a little bit less attractive, in that it's inherently difficult to provide work from home in a place-bound sector. But we are really encouraging leadership teams to explore, how do we maybe change up the timetable? How do we explore ways that we can provide that flexibility? Because it is a key, I guess, element in this attraction and retention. And I guess when we think about attraction and retention, it's really, there's a lot of factors that go into that. And one of the, I guess, really interesting insights, which speaks a bit to that work-life balance part, was we asked a question in 2020. So I guess pre-pandemic, or just at the very early stages of the pandemic, and asked teachers what their experience was like in the education sector on a few areas, and whether they thought that was better or worse than other industries. And we found that social connection and workplace community was really high, broad and interesting job description was high, training career development, 69% said that that was better. The empowering leadership and management styles was also pretty strong at 67%. Remuneration, including leave and non-monetary rewards, was 62%, so second from the bottom, but was still 62% thought that that was better in the education sector than other sectors. And 59% for work-life balance thought that there was better in the education sector than other sectors. Now, just, I guess, 3 years on, we ran this same question with teachers in the post-COVID experience, and work-life balance has dropped to 35% who think that's better in the education sector than others. And remuneration, including leave and non-monetary rewards, has dropped to 41%, so a 20 percentage point drop. And then empowering leadership and management styles has also dropped from 67% to 51%, so almost 20% there. So I think those key shifts are really important for school leaders to be aware of, that what was once viewed as a perk hasn't kept pace with what other industries are providing. And that is part of the challenge when we look at attracting and retaining the next generation of teachers. I know that we also, dug into this study, a really interesting question of whether people have considered leaving the teaching profession. And I thought, Ash, maybe you want to speak to that one, because it is a fun stat. Well, not a fun, but a, sobering stat.
Yeah, it's amazing. And to see that, that question. So, I'm just trying to find the exact stat. Was it 2 in 3?
Yes.
2 in 3 have considered leaving the profession, which is, for me, I think, like, when people ask me what's the, like, it's just such a high amount, like two in three teachers have considered leaving the profession, and we need teachers. And just to see that. And then we also kind of segmented that, I know, by level of experience, and correct me if I'm wrong, Soph, but I think it was 75% of those with 11 plus years of experience have considered leaving, 71% mm-hmm. of 6 to 10 years experience, and still 54% with 5 years or less. So it's kind of across all areas, but particularly losing some of those teachers who probably thought this is my lifelong vocation and calling, who've got the knowledge, information and legacy, to lose them, to lose any great teacher is, I imagine, a challenge for a school, whether they've got long tenure or not, but particularly some of those, that would be hard for someone, I think, even in this profession. And it speaks to me and says, oh, wow, maybe there are some things here that need to change. If people who've been in the profession for such a long time, who've committed, I feel like I know teachers who were born to be teachers, and maybe there's some of them saying, well, it's not worth it anymore. I don't know. It's challenging to see some of those stats.
Yeah, that sense of it's not worth it anymore is pretty accurate, that it's that sense of, like, I'm doing a lot and yet I could be getting paid better with greater flexibility over here. And part of it, I think, as well, is in COVID, we really saw that reprioritization of people's lives, that work wasn't everything, but it became this refocus on family. And I think part of this is that we're seeing that refocus on, or the recalibration of priorities, that work isn't the absolute number one. And even recently, I've heard of people turning down promotions, and this is more in the corporate world than teaching, but that they you know, an exceptional promotion. They went, you know what? I'm actually happy doing what I'm doing with time for my family. And that's my highest priority, which, you know, that warmed my heart. I was like, yes, I applaud you for that. But, you know, maybe 5 years ago, those stories weren't particularly common because it was this pursuit of success and when is enough enough. But I guess COVID just really reprioritized a lot of people's lives. And so when we look across the education sector, it is a concern because that is 2/3 of teachers that have considered leaving the teaching profession in the last 2 years. So it's really current, I guess. And what concerns me when I look at those stats is, yes, 75%. So 3 in 4 teachers that have been teaching for 11 years or more have considered leaving in the last 2 years. So those with longevity and tenure are considering leaving. But those that have just invested a number of years in training, like half of them are going, this isn't actually what I thought it was going to be. And so they're considering leaving as well. And probably just to really hit it home, and I apologize, not the most comforting way, but teachers, they're not just leaving, but they're not recommending the profession either. So the same study that we did in 2020, we found that more than half, so 53% of teachers would be extremely or very likely to recommend a teaching career to someone looking to start or change a career. Just 3 years later, that has dropped to 24%. So that means only 1 in 4 teachers that you currently have are saying, hey, join the profession. Now, that's not enough to, I guess, keep rebuilding to the extent of teachers that we need in this country. And so we explored in the report, I guess, a few solutions or how we can, what we need to focus to rectify this. And, you know, culture is absolutely key. And that's the culture of the school itself, that anyone, whether they're in education or not, they're choosing their workplaces based on culture. It's one of the key differentiators. And so what I find encouraging, though, is that culture is directly in the hands of the leader. They've got control over the culture in their organization. And so it's not just this external wind that you are having to respond to, but you can invest in that, and you can you know, invest in what we would say are the 7 components of healthy culture, which we did that whole study last year. But that vision, leadership, meaningful work, team connections and communications, well-being, values and shared behavior, and training and development, all of those come in to comprise culture, and a focus on investing into those key areas is what helps to set schools apart. And also alongside that is that training and development. We know that that is absolutely crucial for people today. To in every role, people are wanting to grow. And how do we provide or set schools up not just to be learning hubs for students, but also learning hubs for staff? And then the third key element is to really, I guess, explore how they can provide flexibility, because we found when we asked those that had considered leaving, I love surveys for this, you can go, oh, have you considered leaving? And then it's like, okay, well, why? So those that had considered leaving, 72% considered leaving for greater work-life balance. And then the second most likely option was the ability to work from home and other jobs. And that was at 44%. So it's almost twice as likely that they are choosing to leave for this greater work-life balance, which I think, you know, as we said earlier, that all the trends play into each other, that comes to that teacher burnout, that there's this desire for how do I actually do life well? So those were, I guess, some of the antidotes or how we can invest in attracting and retaining incredible people to this incredibly rewarding profession. And probably just one last thing that I would speak to in relation to culture, and Simon Breakspeare shared this thought with us, was that it's really important to be able to communicate well why this place in this time and for this reason, and that teachers are not just necessarily wanting to come and work in the education sector, but they're wanting to come and work in a certain school for a certain time and for a certain reason. And if leaders can articulate that well, that can play a key role in helping them work to shift the conversation around the attraction and retention of teachers to their school.
Yeah, I remember seeing that quote from Dr. Simon Breakspeare and you sharing that at the event and in the report. And I just thought that's really profound and summarizes a lot of what the research is saying. but also, yeah, around innovative and creative ways for schools to get, you know, flexibility within and improve that work-life balance. And I'm hopeful that perhaps even the first trend we talked about in the previous episode, you know, artificial intelligence, what are the ways that these AI tools can eliminate some of the really intensive administrative tasks that we know teachers are carrying, or what can free them up to A, probably have more time with their families or loved ones, or time outside of work not spent prepping, but then also for the students, and to focus on what they're learning and who they're becoming. So yeah, it's a really, really important trend, I think, for us to be exploring. And you gave it some really great airtime on the podcast, but also in the report with some really great insights as well. So very, very important. And the final disruptor that we talked about in the report that we investigated was achieving educational reform in a risk-averse culture. Soph, I wonder if you could explain to our listeners what we meant by this final trend.
Yeah, this one was, I guess, it speaks to more of the structures in which education has to operate, some of the government requirements in which it has to operate, and even a lot of educational experts, they talked about the rise of everyone's an expert and the external commentating on the education sector from people who don't necessarily have the experience or expertise to be making some of those claims. And I guess there was this articulation that educators need to, I guess, speak back about their profession. They've trained in it. They work in it every single day. They know those trends, and they know what works for young people. And so there is this sense of how do you actually have educators having the conversation around what education reform needs to look like, rather than it being just at a political level. So it's this bringing people into the conversation and some of the, I guess, learnings or desires of particularly the educational experts when they looked across the education landscape and what they would love to see to start to shift the experience for teachers, to start to shift the experience for education going forward. It was around providing greater autonomy for schools to, I guess, be flexible in what they provided for students, that there is a full curriculum and there is a lot that is, I guess, specified. And that's good to bring a certain quality across the education sector, but it doesn't necessarily create space for leaders and teachers to tailor, to customize, to have flexibility to respond to those that are sitting right in front of them, which is the expectation of parents and the expectation of students, yet they're not necessarily feeling like the system is set up for them to allow to do that. So there's this desire for greater autonomy. There's also this desire to innovate on the structure, to go, okay, does school have to be 9 to 3? Does it have to be a teacher physically present? Now, yes, there's requirements of duty and of care, but there is, it feels, based on the conversations that we had, it felt like there was very little permission for the education sector to innovate in this space, because there was this, I guess, desire, or for stakeholders, the expectation of no, school's 9 to 3, like that's what it is. But if we look at how much the workplace has shifted in structure in just the last couple of years, there is a desire to have a little bit more flexibility and freedom to explore some of those changing structures of what that could look like in schools to help provide flexibility for teachers and not have, I guess, a cookie cutter approach, because every school is different. Every state even is different and how they can, I guess, have that flexibility and permission. And probably just the last two that I'll speak to here, I know we're giving you a full download of information here today, but is reflecting on the one key score at the end of a schooling experience, that we talk about the life skills, we talk about equipping people for a lifelong learning, we talk about not just academics but holistic, yet at the same time, that is all kind of funneled into one key metric when people leave school. And there's a desire from school leadership to have a conversation around that and go, maybe this should look different. If we're equipping them for a different world, maybe we need to be actually reviewing our current measures and metrics of assessment to give what more of a true view of success looks like from an education approach that is not just solely academic driven, but has more of a holistic nature to it. And the last one is just that desire to be more collaborative across the sector, that to bring about educational reform. The educational leaders are saying, let's work together. Let's unite our voice about the key issues. Let's not put each other into silos of Catholic, independent, government, but actually let's keep students and their well-being and their outcomes at the centre and go, how do we use all the resources that we have to bring about lasting change and better outcomes for our students?
Such an important trend, I think, to acknowledge as well, just that, you know, I think every organization realizes, every person living in 2023 realizes that the world's changing and we need to innovate and respond, but just that there are some constraints on this sector, particularly in how it's structured, as to how much teachers and leaders can do that. And I think that comes from the fact that it's, we've got legacy, these been set up for the intention of being fair and equal across the board, you know, so that there is a common experience for students. But yeah, how we tweak and change in this kind of environment is challenging, but it's required to be thinking about. So it's of course why we included it in here. We also included in the report a bit of a little section around the importance of leadership. And so I wondered if you could just to wrap us up in this episode and to wrap up our summary of this research that people can, of course, go and delve deeper into if they would like, I guess why that's important. I mean, we even talked about culture and we know from our research that leaders set the culture within their school and they need to be aware of these trends. They need to, you know, be responding to them. Is that why you think it's important that at a leadership level, leaders, I guess, take that responsibility and why and how, you know, they can do that?
Yeah. Throughout this report, it just was highlighted to us again and again and again that everything rises and falls on leadership, that leadership, you know, culture is most effective when it's owned by the collective, but leaders play an incredible role in helping to set and hold people accountable to that and saying, this goes at this organization, this doesn't. And leaders have the opportunity to cast that vision. They've got the opportunity to inspire people to come along on that journey. And probably one of the other key reasons why we really drummed in that leadership is so important is because when we looked at in the workplace, what blockers do people have to them thriving at work? And the key elements were being overworked and stressed, limited flexibility, management structures, lack of resources and training, leadership itself, a sense of resistance to change. Like, there were so many of them. But really, at the end of the day, when we categorize those by key themes, that 9 out of the 14 blockers for people thriving at work were issues to do with leadership. And then the others of 4 were linked to culture, and then others were kind of different themes after that. But when you look at that, to go for people to flourish in their place of work, the key elements and the key dials to shift are in the hands of the leader and are in the attitudes, responses of leadership. And so if leaders can lean in, can listen well to their people and to provide solutions to some of those challenges, then teachers thrive, students thrive when teachers are thriving, and the educational experience for everyone involved improves. And so that's why we really, I guess, summarized or landed our report with everything truly does rise and fall on leadership.
A huge report, Soph. I know that you've sunk a lot of time, effort, energy, hours into that. And I know that you're really passionate as well about the education sector and sharing that research through, you know, the podcast, through our articles, but of course, you know, with schools on the ground, at their PD days, at their boardroom levels, as are the rest of our advisors. So really valuable, amazing insights. Thank you so much for your time and for all the energy and investment you've made into this report and into the education sector as a whole.
Thank you. It's always an absolute delight. One of my favorite things to do.
I think that has definitely translated in this episode and the previous episode of the podcast as well. And if you would like to download the free infographic summary of this research, or if you'd like to obtain a copy of the full report, you can just head to McCrindle.com and go to the resources section of our website, and that will take you through the prompts that you need to do that. And of course, if you'd like to stay up to date with our latest insights across a whole range of different sectors and topics and industries, you can subscribe to this podcast, you can follow us on social media, or you can head to McCrindle.com to find out more. So as always, thank you so much for listening, and bye for now.